So in this talk, I'm going to take an example of a function of two variables, and I'm going to pick a point in the domain of the function. This is actual numerical values here, such that the function has partial derivatives with respect to both variables at the point, but the function is not differentiable, right? The gradient vector doesn't exist at the point. Okay? So even though the partial derivatives exist, the function is not differentiable because the derivative, which is just the gradient vector, doesn't exist. Okay, so let's first go over an example which comes up in another context, and that's this. So f of x comma y is xy over x square plus y square away from the origin, and it's zero at the origin. And I'm interested in the behavior at the origin. Now, this function came up as an example of what?
Continuity.
Yeah, what did it show?
A separately continuous function may not be jointly continuous.
Where jointly continuous just means, so it showed that separately continuous. What does separately continuous mean?
It means it's continuous on x direction and y direction.
It's holding the other variable constant.
Mm-hmm.
And continuity means that it's a jointly continuous in both variables. What does joint continuity mean? It means that sort of if the point is close to this point, the function value will also be close. Regardless, you're not just approaching along the x and y directions. The separate continuity is just approaching along the x and y directions. Continuity is sort of anything close by. The value of the function should be close. Okay. And why did this work? Well, the reason it works is that at the origin, so at any point other than the origin, it's just continuous in the usual sense, and it's also separately continuous. But at the origin, it's separately continuous because along the x-axis, it's zero as a function, and along the y-axis, also it's zero as a function. So therefore, when you approach on the x or y lines, then it's just identically zero. So it's continuous at this point along each direction. On the other hand, if you approach along a diagonal direction, like that, then it's not, or that, or any other diagonal direction, the limit is not equal to the value. So you can see more on that in a video on this particular function. But now I just want to say briefly why this gives me an example of a function for which the partials exist, but the derivative doesn't. So why do the partials f sub x and f sub y exist at 0, 0? What is f sub x at 0, 0?
Zero.
Zero. Why is zero?
Why is zero?
Yeah, why is the partial with respect to x at the origin equal to zero? Well, you know why it's true, right? What does f look like if you restrict it to the x-axis?
It looks like horizontal line.
No, but what does the value of the function look like on the x-axis?
Zero.
Zero. So the function itself is zero everywhere on the x-axis. So if you differentiate the zero function, you'll get?
Zero.
Zero. So that's why f sub x of zero, zero is zero. What about f sub y of zero, zero?
Zero.
Why?
It's the value along y-axis is zero.
Is identically zero. So if you differentiate that at zero, you still get zero. Okay, so the partial derivatives exist. So by the way, the partial derivative existing is sort of like a slight strengthening of separate continuity. Right? Separate continuity just means it's continuous holding other variables constant. Partial derivative existing means it's differentiable holding other variables constant. Okay? So, however, it's not differentiable at the origin. Why is it not differentiable? Well, it's not continuous to begin with. Right? And if something's differentiable, it should be continuous. Okay, so this gives you an example to illustrate this, but I want to now take another slightly different example. Okay. So I'm going to take the example here. It's a somewhat different flavored example. It has its pluses and minuses. So the cube root of the product of the coordinates. So this function is continuous everywhere, because it's composing continuous functions. Okay. What does the function look like? Okay, let's do it this way. So, let's say for x non-zero and y non-zero. So both coordinates are non-zero. What can we say about f sub x? What is f sub x?
You want me to say the whole thing? 1/3.
Well, I'll just
x to the negative 2/3. Y to the 1/3.
Okay. So you just expanded the product and then did the differentiation. Okay. And fy of, are we here? Fy of
yes.
x comma y is 1/3 x to the 1/3 y to the
2/3.
-2/3. Okay. So both f sub x and f sub y exist when x and y are non-zero. This is the usual differentiation. So now suppose x is non-zero, but y is zero.
That'd just be zero.
Okay, so what is the x partial? Is just zero. What about the y partial?
Y partial doesn't exist.
Well, so this actually f sub x of x and y is just y is 0. So you could put 0 here if you want. The y partial doesn't exist.
This is a silly question. Why can't we just plug y equals 0 into fxy?
Well, you cannot. I mean, you could do that just to get a guess, but you can actually do it. Sort of from first principles or whatever, if you want. But yeah, you could do it from. So this one, for why is f sub x equal to 0? Well, in fact, on this line, on the y-axis, sorry, on the x-axis, right? That's on the x-axis, the function identically looks like the what function? On the x-axis, when y equals 0, what does this function look like?
0.
So it's just a 0 function everywhere. Since it's a zero function, it's the f sub x is just zero. Now, what about f sub y?
Y doesn't exist.
Well, f sub y is really like you have fixed x, and so x to the 1/3 comes out as a constant, and then you're just asking whether y to the 1/3 is differentiable at zero. The cube root function, is that differentiable at zero? And that's not differentiable at zero.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's the reason. Okay, for x equals 0, y non-zero. What do you get? So,
f sub x
doesn't exist. F sub y of x comma y. By the way, x is just 0. Just like here, y was just 0. So, what is that?
Zero.
In fact, the function f itself is zero on the y-axis. Now, what happens when x and y are both zero? What can you say about the values fx and fy?
Both zero.
Why?
Oh, you mean f sub x and f sub y?
Yeah.
They don't exist.
Why do you think that?
Individually,
well, so let's go back and think about this a bit. So what are you actually raised a very good question. You cannot just plug in the expressions directly. Okay, so you have to think about this. So here's your origin. Okay, so you are here. Now, how do you figure out what is f sub x? What do you need to do? You need to figure out what the function looks like on the x-axis and then differentiate that function at zero. What does the function look like on the x-axis?
looks like 0.
The 0 function. What's the derivative of the 0 function at 0?
0.
0. So f sub x is equal to 0. Okay? Because f is 0 on the x-axis. So f sub x is 0 at the origin. What about f sub y? What does f look like on the y-axis?
x equals 0. Look at the
function equals 0 mm-hmm. on the y. So x equals 0. So when you plug in x equals 0, what do you get for the function?
0.
Okay. So what is f sub y at 0? In fact, everywhere here it's 0. So f sub y is
0.
Also 0. So f sub x of x comma y. I'll just write as 0, 0. F sub y of 0, 0 is 0. But you are on the right track when you notice that if you actually take the limit of this expression as x approaches 0 and y approaches 0, that doesn't really make sense, right? Which makes us a little more suspicious. Okay? So, because If the partial derivative existed, if the gradient vector existed, you might expect somewhat nicer behavior. This just seems to happen to be zero by chance. So how do you actually try to show that the gradient vector doesn't exist? So I'm claiming that at this point, so my x naught, y naught will be 0, 0. I'm claiming that at this point, although the partials exist and are equal to 0, the gradient vector doesn't exist. So, how would I show the gradient vector doesn't exist? Now, it's very hard to define the gradient vector directly, but in this case, it's enough to compute a directional derivative and show that that directional derivative doesn't exist. Okay? Because if the gradient vector existed, then you would have directional derivatives in all directions. Right? Because the directional derivative in any direction is just that unit vector dot with the gradient vector. So, consider the direction.
X equals to y.
Yeah. So what's the unit vector in that direction?
1/√2.
In both coordinates, yeah. So what is the directional derivative of f at? Well, it's a limit as h approaches 0, f of h down here. What do you get here? Is everything captured?
Yes.
Okay, f of what? Well, h times u, right? Well, it's going to be 0, 0 plus h u. So what will come here? What are the coordinates here?
0.
No, that will be subtracting f of 0, 0. Yeah. So it's 0 plus what?
1/√2.
Go on. 1/√2 times?
Times h.
H, right. Okay, what's that? Are we here? So what does this become? h/√2 times h/√2 to the 1/3. What's f of 0, 0?
0.
So that's just ignore and over h. Okay. What does that simplify to?
It simplifies to h to 1/3/2.
And what is the numerator? What does that become? That becomes h to the 2/3
mm-hmm. over divided by h.
2 to the 1/3. So, and then when you bring that down, what happens? What's the overall thing?
H
down?
Over 1/3.
In the denominator, right?
No. In the numerator, h to the 1/3 is 2 is in the denominator.
Both will be in the denominator. Okay, let's just do this. So, yeah. Limit, have we here? H approaches 0, h to the 2/3 over 2 to the 1/3 h. Now you want to bring this down here. You'll get, you have 1 here, right? You get 1 minus 2/3.
Oh.
Hmm? And the 2 to the 1/3 also you can bring down here.
Okay. Yes, you're right.
Sorry. And what's left here?
1.
Okay. What's this limit now? As h approaches 0, what does this go to?
0. It doesn't exist.
The denominator goes to 0. Mm-hmm. So
the limit itself doesn't exist.
Okay. Does not exist. Great. So we have shown that the directional derivative in this direction doesn't exist. What does that mean about the gradient vector?
The gradient vector doesn't exist.
Yeah, because if it did exist, then the directional derivative in this direction would be the dot product of this with the gradient vector, and we would get a numerical value. So the gradient vector doesn't exist, which means the function is not differentiable at the point, and so we have this example, the partials exist, but the gradient vector doesn't. Okay.